¿Qué tal? Hemos comenzado ya el último trimestre de este año. Vamos a ver las previsiones que se manejan para cerrar este 2014 en las bolsas y también, ya que estamos, pues vamos a ponernos en el año 2015 y ver hacia dónde van a ir los mercados. Hoy nos visita por primera vez aquí en la Bolsa de Madrid Stijn Jacobsen, que es el economista jefe, uno de ellos, de Saxo Bank. ¿Qué tal? Buenas tardes. Good morning.
Good morning.
Bueno, vamos a comenzar, ¿no? Haciendo esta entrevista nos centramos en primer término en mercados. Queremos hablar, como les decía, de este final de 2014 y también del año 2015, porque las previsiones ya están casi encima de la mesa después de lo que estamos viendo en los índices de renta variable, evidentemente ya tras el verano y tras esta resaca que estamos teniendo aquí en Europa del Banco Central Europeo. Bueno, en primer término queremos preguntarle por las expectativas de Saxo Bank acerca de las bolsas.
Well, bear markets are defined as a market which is more than 10% down. So mathematically, yes, it's very likely. Also because we haven't had a bear market in the last 18 months. I think we are increasingly getting close to the 5, 6, 7% drawdown, but 10% is very likely, yes.
Mm-hmm. Bueno, aparte de todo esto, evidentemente en Europa la situación está bastante más complicada. Quizás Estados Unidos sea el mercado favorito por algunos expertos. No sé si es su caso, si Estados Unidos lo prefiere así.
So if we're talking asset classes, I've really only had one trade all year, and that is to be long fixed income. Mm-hmm. The one change I've done is that I have been very negative on European growth, in particularly German growth, which has now materialized. So I've taken profit on being long German bunds and Danish government bonds and Spanish bonos, and now I change all my risk in fixed income pretty much to the US. So in other words, I'm expecting a slowdown in US growth, which will lead to significantly lower US interest rates and growth overall.
Mm-hmm. Hablando precisamente de Estados Unidos, el recorrido de la bolsa americana es evidente, está siendo muy alcista. Lo que no sabemos si es, como dicen algunos analistas, se espera ya una corrección de cara a lo que queda de este 2014.
Yeah, so my personal view and what I've been writing about pretty much since the early summer is that I always thought that in the second half of this year, which now means in Q4, mm-hmm. we will have a correction in the magnitude of 20 to 25%. And the reason for that is that the growth we create in the world today is 75% driven by credit and only 25% from productivity. So in other words, all the growth there is in the US and in the world is because you use your credit card. It is not because you're more productive. And as such, I think the stock market needs to revalue itself. And I think we may be seeing growing signs, as you and I talk today, that there is a correction on the way. Of course, 20-25% is a far away from 5-6%, which we are down right now. But I know this morning that a lot of markets has turned negative. Australia is now negative for the year. Some of the big growth markets of the world is now turning negative. So the good stock story that we were told for the first half of 2014 is increasingly, not only in the US, but across the globe, becoming less of a good story. And what we are left with is very low growth and no mandate for change or reforms in Spain, in Europe, in the US, or anywhere in the world for that matter.
Mm-hmm. Bueno, pasemos a hablar evidentemente del Banco Central Europeo. La semana pasada tuvimos una importante reunión allí, los mercados estaban pendientes de ellos y la reacción, lo cierto es que no fue del todo positiva. Vimos caídas muy abultadas, aquí en el caso del IBEX 35 fue la mayor desde el mes de enero, más allá de un 3,12% en concreto se dejó el mercado nacional al día siguiente. Pero lo relevante, ¿no?, en este momento de lo que están pendientes los expertos es si se producirá un QE en las bolsas, en el mercado europeo, perdón, y que afectará por lo tanto evidentemente a la liquidez de las bolsas.
So QE to be implemented is first of all practically very difficult, and politically right now both Germany but also France is saying no thank you. So what we've seen from the ECB is that the ECB mandate is very wide in scope but very small in size. So to some extent on the ECB, I think we've reached the end of the rainbow. We have lowered interest rates as much as we could. Mm-hmm. We have created, you know, lending programs, the LTRO and now the TLTRO. We have created the ABS program, all of which, you know, down the road will have an impact. But for now, for Q4, for Q1, for Q2 even, or next year, there's no material support from lower interest rate from the marketplace coming to you, except from the fact that deflation has become the number one concern, not only in Spain, but all of Europe.
Uh-huh. Hablemos precisamente de lo que decía Cristina en estos momentos, de ese programa ABS, de ese programa CBP, a fin de cuentas es la compra, ¿no?, de deuda, de intentar fomentar un poco el crédito aquí en la eurozona. No sé si habrá sentido satisfecho con estas medidas.
I think again, in terms of what it's trying to achieve, absolutely, but the implementation and the size of the program is too little, too late and not enough. If we stay on the ABS program, the positive side is that a typical European corporation finances itself by 70% bank lending and 30% funding or ABS from the capital markets. In the US, they fund themselves 70% through ABS and 30% from bank lending. So one of the reasons why that corporations in the US have had better access to credit has been the mere fact that they have a very extensive ABS program. Mm-hmm. So what I think this will do for the European market is that it will make sure that there are more supply of ABS in 2 years, in 3 years, in 5 years from now. But again, from now until 2060, there's going to be no material impact from the ABS. So yes, it is correct in focusing on getting more credit intermediation from the capital markets rather than directly from the banks. Mm-hmm. And in terms of the targeted LTRO, don't forget that it's really only replacing the LTRO, which means that there's not going to be a lot of renewed financing because the funding cost with the negative deposit rate and everything, mm-hmm. it's making it more and less appealing to the banks. And I think, to be honest, every single treasurer in Spain of the banks, in Germany, in Denmark, they're all focusing on the AQR, the Asset Quality Review Program. So these policies come in the middle of a lot of noise from, you know, how sound are the banking system, what banks is going to be, you know, smelly by the end of the AQR exercise, mm-hmm. and vice versa. So yes, I think all of these programs has a long-term impact, but the problem is the world, wrongly, are looking for quick decisions and quick solutions short term.
Uh-huh. En Estados Unidos se va a producir el final del conocido tapering en español, tapering para ellos en inglés. No se ve la expectativa que pueden tener ustedes respecto a los mercados, del impacto que puede tener esto.
Tapering is a misunderstanding. I think people fail to understand that tapering is a mere reflection of the budget deficits in the US. Uh-huh. The US budgets have halved, and hence tapering needs to stop, because there's no financing need of the deficit in the US anymore. So what Yellen has done poorly is to communicate. She's never been able to tell the market, tapering is one process, normalizing interest rates is another one. So right now the market says, well, tapering is the first phase of normalization. No, it's not. It is a practical exercise of balance sheet, a matching where you have the deficit on one side and you have the size of tapering, i.e. Federal Reserve buying government bonds on the other side. As this one goes down on the left-hand side, on the right-hand side it also needs to go down. But it is still miscommunicated, so yes, there is a trade. And no, I don't think the Federal Reserve will hike interest rate, not in January 2015, not in June 2015. I think we'll be all the way to January 2016 at a bare minimum before we see high interest rates.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about levels, no? Pasamos al tema de materias primas. Queremos saber un poco la previsión que tienen desde Saxo Bank para cuestiones concretas. Todo este asunto del que venimos hablando, tanto BCE como Reserva Federal por el otro lado, tiene repercusión directa en primer término sobre el par euro-dólar. Lo tenemos en el 1,26. Está cayendo considerablemente, además, a lo largo de los últimos meses. Y queremos ver un poco cómo va a terminar este año, según ustedes.
So my FX strategist John Hardy has been short the euro, and I think he will call it lower, but you're asking me, so here's my take. I think the fact that US is slowing and Europe is already expected to be very negative means that interest rate will go down more in the US than in Europe. So I think we are seeing the peak strength of the US dollar in this quarter. I think from now onwards the dollar will be weaker against the yen and also against the euro. So I think we will see a low in the euro inside 1 to 2 pfennigs. Mm-hmm. And I think the target for me, if you ask me for end of the year, is probably 132, 131.
Mm-hmm. Siguiendo con la cuestión de materias primas, dejamos al euro dólar de lado. Estamos viendo en las últimas semanas importantísimas caídas, tanto en el oro como en el Brent. Bueno, la justificación puede ser pues diferentes, ¿no?, en función de a quién se le pregunte, pero lo cierto es que las caídas son muy importantes. ¿Cuál es la previsión que manejan ustedes para estos dos grupos, digamos, de materias primas?
So for crude, of course, or Brent, both of them have a huge oversupply of from the marketplace. So there's a lot of oil sloshing around the system. This happens at a time where world growth is coming down. The IMF today moved their expectation. And I tell you this, if IMF is negative, then the world is really, really negative because they're always positive.
So
this is coming, excess supply together with lower expectation. But again, it's also a dollar story. We've seen a strengthening 10% of the dollar over the last three months. So I also think if I believe that the strength of the dollar is peaking here, I also have to think that the downside of oil, and also, of course, we are going into the coal season, so that will be, you know, cause inventories will come down dramatically. So I think this 90-92 level in Brent is probably the low, and which I think equates to about 85-86 in the West Texas oil. And the story is the same with the gold. Gold is negatively impacted by the fact that we have lower interest, and we have lower inflation rates. And a relatively stable interest rates, which means that real rates is actually decreasing in the world. I think inflation expectation, I think the dollar, I think the everything is turning in between this quarter and next quarter. So if as long as gold is above 1150, 1180, it's still in an upside cycle for me. Even if it tests 1150, I'm not too concerned. So I think the end target for me in gold will be something like 1300. But again, like the dollar, I think gold is seeing the low, I think commodity is seeing the low, and I think the Brent is seeing the low.
Bueno, esos tres activos a la baja, nos comentaba Stine Jacobsen. Cambiamos de asunto, hablamos de acciones en concreto. Nos vamos a Estados Unidos, donde bueno, es obligado casi hablar de grandes nombres. Facebook ha cumplido hace nada pues un aniversario en bolsa. Existen previsiones respecto a esta red social interesantes. Hablamos de ganancias de un 16% aproximado de cara a los próximos meses en bolsa. Hablamos de Tesla, de Micron Technologies o quizás de GoPro. Ya saben, son estas cámaras, ¿no?, que graban en directo y que se pueden colocar por cualquier parte del cuerpo. No sé muy bien la previsión que existe respecto a estas tecnológicas en Estados Unidos para este año y también para el próximo año.
So these companies has benefited massively from lower interest rate and chasing yield, and investor who felt and experienced there were no alternatives to equity. Now the world believes that interest rate is going up. I don't, as you know, but the world thinks and the consensus that interest rate Fed is going to hike. So to some extent, you're removing one of the reasons, many of the reasons why people have been buying these stocks, because internet stocks, social stocks, doesn't trade on earnings. It trades on potential multiples going forwards. And that is risk-free as long as interest rate is zero, and that there's no alternative. But as the world slows down, as deflation becomes an issue, as energy costs reverses back higher up, there will be less interest in these stocks. So I think the terms of technology, you know, I'm old enough to have been around both in 87 and in 2000. And it, you know, this is like 2000. We are pricing stocks that is not gonna make money on the bottom line for the next 10 years worth gazillions of dollars. So can it go up another 10-15%? Absolutely, but your downside risk is 50% in all the stocks you just mentioned.
Bueno, pendientes de si vamos a ver esa burbuja quizás en cuestiones tecnológicas. Cerramos, bueno, pues con una cuestión evidentemente de cara al 2015, es la cuestión obligada, sabemos la previsión que tienen ya para los mercados, un poco por activos, vamos a preguntar también a Stine Jacobsen, ¿dónde exactamente colocarían ustedes desde Saxo Bank ese dinero?
So fixed income will be my biggest portion still, as I talked about. I think lower interest rate, lower growth is almost a given. So a big chunk of my money, so say 70% will be in fixed income and primarily in US growth, lack of US growth. In terms of the equity portion, let's say it's 25% of the rest, I will certainly be buying mines. As you know, I think the dollar is turning. I think the commodity prices are turning. I think even that ultimately in 2015, we're going to see more growth and more inflation. So over the next 2 to 3 quarters, I will buy into mining. I'm very long Alcoa, who reports this week. I'm very long and interesting in buying into gold mines, not gold itself, but gold mines. I am very negative on oil industry. I think the oil industry is cash reserve negative, so I'll be long mining companies, against oil companies as a spread trade. Mm-hmm. In the equity space, and I liked insurance companies, life insurance companies, because they have a huge portion of their net wealth in fixed income. If you believe fixed income is going up, insurance companies will go up in price too. So that is the sectors I like. In the equity space, I like commodities. I want to buy, I'm long already the ETF DBA, which is commodity agriculture. I want to buy more of that. And I'm increasingly also want to buy the DBC, which is the more broadly based commodity, as these inflation expectations and the dollar turns around within the next 1 or 2 quarters. And that leaves me very little room for cash, but fixed income is cash. And I think I want to say to your viewers, the good thing about fixed income is that, and you need to remember this always, that's the only way you get a free put on the equity market. So I don't need to be short the equity market in my portfolio. I can be long all these things we just talked about, because being long a too high overweight of fixed income, I actually have a put on the equity market for free while I wait for this to break up. Because I'm not negative on companies, I'm not negative on Spain, I'm not negative on our ability to come out, but I'm negative on the consensus, which is that the US is going great and everything else is doing poorly. I think the rebalancing we will see is that Europe will do a little bit better than we expect, which is the expectation is pretty bad. And I think the US will do significantly worse than we expect. Mm-hmm. As we rebalance, there is a price to be paid on lower growth, lower deflation, but that will be replaced by something better as we come into the second half of 2015.
Mm-hmm. Bueno, pues a la expectativa de que la situación mejore, damos las gracias a Stijn Jacobsen por estar con nosotros. Thank you so much.
Muchas gracias.
Bueno, muchas gracias, nos dice en español. Le vemos muy a menudo a Stijn Jacobsen aquí en España y siempre es un placer tener al economista jefe de Saxo Bank con nosotros. Saben que el resto de información económica la tienen siempre en nuestra página web.